Excellent. We have we've been with the book of Job for 4 weeks, and now we are jumping from Job back into the New Testament. We are with Jesus and his disciples. Jesus is in Jerusalem, and he is in a combative mood. He goes to the temple from Mark chapter 10 to Mark chapter 12, and when he's there, he gets into these confrontations with different political religious groups that come to the temple. First with the Herodians, and then the Pharisees, and then the Sadducees, and then here in our passage with the scribes. Now, none of these groups liked each other very much. The Herodians and the Pharisees especially politically didn't see eye to eye. The Pharisees and the Sadducees didn't like each other at all. The scribes thought they were better than everyone else because they knew the scriptures very well, kind of like ministers and pastors. And yet, they all find common ground in saying, we don't like this Jesus. We don't like the message he brings. We don't like the gospel he's preaching and the image of the kingdom that he is giving people. Why? Well, it might take away our initiative and our prerogative and our power when he goes around telling people that when you're poor, the kingdom of God belongs to you. When you are a peacemaker, the kingdom belongs to you. When you forgive, the kingdom belongs to you. And so in the preceding chapters, all these groups come up to Jesus in the temple and they want to catch him out. They come with trick questions. First, the Herodians and the Pharisees say, Jesus, should we pay taxes to the emperor, the Roman emperor? It's a good question. If Jesus says yes, they have grounds to say, oh, he's just a puppet of Rome. Don't listen to him. If he says no, they can run to the Romans and say, this guy's a revolutionary, you should lock him up. Jesus answers them by saying, well, whose money is on the coin? Give it back to whoever's image is on the coin. The next group come, the Sadducees. They want to catch Jesus out asking about the resurrection. They say, Jesus, you're the smart teacher. If a woman is married to a man and then he dies and she marries his brother, then in the resurrection, who's she actually married to? Aren't the brothers going to get into a fist fight? You know, fighting about this woman that they're both married. And Jesus says, well, your question doesn't make any sense. And then we have our passage. There's a scribe who's watching all this happen. He comes up to Jesus. He's got a question as well. His question isn't so much a trick question. It's just a very good one. He says, teacher, I've heard what you said about the taxes, heard what you said about the resurrection. I know you're trying to talk to all these different groups who all have their own fingers in different pies. But let me ask you this. What's the greatest commandment? If Jesus gets this wrong, he loses all credibility. Now, I've forgotten the exact amount, but there is something like 657 different commandments in the Old Testament. Jesus says, just go back to that first slide for a second, Doug, thank you. Jesus says, the first is Deuteronomy 6, what we just did. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind and with all your strength. The second is this, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. There is no other commandment greater than these. Now the problem is, we don't find that part from Deuteronomy 6 and that little suffix at the end, you shall love your neighbor as yourself, as a unit in the Old Testament. They're from two different parts. Hear, O Israel, the Lord is your God, the Lord is one. You shall love the Lord. That's from Deuteronomy. We've done that part. Love your neighbor as yourself is from the book of Leviticus. Different book, different emphasis, different reason for being there. And yet Jesus sees that if you can take this one command from Deuteronomy and this one from Leviticus and make them one, you can sum up, that's the wrong word, you can fulfill all the law, all the prophets, all the commandments. This is why Jesus repeats in all the Gospels, do not think that I came to destroy the law. I came to fulfill it. By teaching that love for God and love for your neighbor go hand in hand. The scribe says, "Teacher, you've answered very well. Indeed, the Lord is one. We must love him with everything we have, and also love our neighbors as we love ourselves." This is the end of verse 33. "This is much more important than all the whole burnt offerings and the sacrifices." When Jesus saw that he answered wisely, he said to him, "You are not far from the kingdom of God." That's the part that I'd like us to focus on today. Because not far from the kingdom of God means he's not there yet, right? He's just not as far away as some others. What is it that the scribe sees in Jesus' answer? And more importantly, what should we be seeing? What should we be hearing? Now, if we jump forward 1500 years to the time of Martin Luther, there was something happening. Maybe put that next slide up and we can keep that one up. That's the one. There was something happening in the Catholic Church in the time of Martin Luther. There was something happening that reminded Luther and his contemporaries of exactly that sentiment the scribe was calling out when he spoke to Jesus. The scribe says, if you understand that you must love God with everything you have and love your neighbor as yourself, then you understand that doing that is worth more than all the burnt offerings in the world. In Luther's time, people had begun to think that if you wanted to avoid hell and eternal damnation, all you had to do was put some money in the right purses. You could pay the Catholic Church via this system of fathers and bishops and archbishops and the Pope himself with money to pardon your sins. And if you've got an uncle or a sister or a father or a mother whose soul you are concerned about, who's passed away, you can even pay the church money to have their soul sprung from hell and sent to heaven. There's something in the time of Jesus that corresponds to the time of Martin Luther, because in the time of Jesus, people believed that if you gave your burnt offerings and enough of them, and if you didn't have burnt offerings, if you gave your money in the temple, then God would reward you for all the money and the offerings that you're giving. Now, I think the reason that today is Reformation Sunday, the reason we celebrate it is not because of Martin Luther. He would turn in his grave if he thought we were celebrating him today. It's not because John Wesley read Martin Luther and felt his heart strangely warmed that we have Reformation Sunday. We call it Reformation Sunday because it is a call to the whole church to be very, very afraid of making the same mistakes as the people, the scribes, in Jesus' time and as the Catholic Church in Luther's time. And I'm not bashing the Catholic Church. They have come to understandings about this process of Scripture and grace and faith in Christ and God's glory since then that have transformed them as well. But I see something happening in our time, in church, in all churches, in the Uniting Church, in all other denominations, everywhere in the world, not only here. We seem to have gone back to the time of Jesus and the time of Luther, where we believe that our good works will somehow guarantee God's grace. That somehow we can convince God by our good behavior to bless us with success, prosperity, family, health, long life, and maybe if you're lucky, even eternity. In a certain sense, we're back 2,000 years ago with Jesus in the temple. In a certain sense, we're back in the Middle Ages with Luther. We have well-meaning leaders, pastors, ministers, scribes who know their Bibles, who tell us that we can somehow convince God to change his mind about us if we only live on the moral line. If we don't make too many mistakes. You've even got some churches who are fond of telling their members that if you give us enough money, somehow God will bless you. And we celebrate Reformation Sunday. And it's fitting that on Reformation Sunday we read Mark 12, verses 28 to 34, and Deuteronomy 6, to remind us that there is nothing we can do to make God change his mind about us. More to the point, there's nothing we can do to make God love us less. And there's nothing we can do to make God love us more. He decides. He has already decided. These five words, we didn't just throw them on the screen. These five words define the way we do church in the Reformed, Protestant, Methodist, Presbyterian, Congregationalist tradition. We say we are saved by grace alone, not by our own acts. We are saved through faith in Christ alone, not by faith in ourselves or in our ministers. We learn about the salvation through Scripture alone, not through self-help books. And even, and this is dangerous, even when your minister is speaking, that's not Scripture. Scripture is your mandate to delve into your own Bible, to find God's Word. In Scripture we learn that all things are made possible for us through Christ alone. Not Christ and whatever else we choose to worship. Not Christ and money. Christ and power. Christ and status. Christ, and Paul will say, Christ and Christ crucified alone. And all things are done not to the glory of men, but to the glory of God alone. I actually think, and we didn't plan it this way, we haven't collected our offerings in this church the way we used to do in a long time. We've had our offering bags at the front and at the exit to the church. Many of us have moved to our electronic offerings, which is wonderful, but we haven't had the offering as an element of our service in a long time. And today I actually think that's quite fitting. Because we need to remove ourselves completely and utterly from the idea that anything we can give can change God's mind about us. The scribe knows this. The scribe says, yes, teacher, Jesus, very good. If you love God and you love your neighbor, you're bang on. You know all the 66 books of the Old Testament. Jesus says, well, actually, you're not too far from the kingdom of God yourself. But beware, you're not there yet. Because all this thinking about loving God and loving our neighbor cannot remain academic. It cannot be a discussion we have in church. It must flow out of these doors. It must go with us into our homes, our places of work, our schools, our circles of influence. We must take our love for God, which you have because you're here, and it must translate into love for our neighbors. You can't have the one without the other. You can't be what's these days called a social, you can't be a social justice warrior and love people and want to better people's lives, but forget that all of this is love for God. You can't just have love for God and act like that is enough. You don't need to love the people around you. Funny word, love. When Deuteronomy uses the word love, hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one, the Lord our God is alone. You shall love the Lord your God. The word there doesn't mean love in the emotional sense that we like to mean it. It means loyalty. You must be loyal to God with everything you have. Your heart, your soul, your mind, your might, your understanding, your wallet, your clothes, your shoes, your hands, your gloves, your kitchen, your refrigerator. All of that needs to be loyal to God. And then you must be loyal to your neighbor as you are loyal to yourself. Maybe that's the hard one. Because maybe if we loved ourselves the way Christ loves us, then love for our neighbors will be easier to achieve. But maybe if you're like me, you need some convincing every morning that in fact all of this is true for you. That we are worthy of God's love. That the price has been paid. That the crucifixion and resurrection of Jesus has secured for us eternal life so that we may give that love and that life to others. So here's what we're going to do. Tommy, if you just want to stick your head out and see how far they are, and tick your watch so they know they should hurry up. Here's what we're going to do. The kids are going to come in. They're going to hand out as many of those leaves as they can. Maybe we have enough, maybe we have too many. It doesn't matter. You're also going to get a pencil. I want you to take that leaf and write something on the inside. And you can write a Bible verse, or a prayer, or a word, or a name. What I'm going to write is simply on the one side, love God. On the other side, love people. If you wanted to write down the sermon today, two sides of the same coin, love God, love people. The music team is going to come forward. Sarah's going to play for us the song we're going to sing in a while. As she's playing, the kids will hand those out. When we've all received our pencils and our papers, then we'll stand, we'll sing In Christ Alone with our music team. When we're done singing, the kids are going to be here in the front. Kids and Joan and Hillary and myself, you're going to bring your leaves to the kids. They're going to hang them on the tree. And in doing that, we're going to do something Martin Luther did, although we don't have wooden doors to bang our messages into, thank goodness. But we're going to hang our faith on the tree of life. We're going to leave it here, and when we go out the doors, we're going to go out loving God and loving His creation. Does that all make sense? Does it sound good? Wonderful. So remain seated. The kids will hand out what they hand out. Sarah's going to play for us In Christ Alone. I will give us a signal to stand, to sing. While we're singing, write down your message. After we've sung, Sarah continues to play. We bring our messages to the front and we hang it on the tree. Let's pray, and then we do all that.
In Christ alone, my hope is found. He is my light, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are still, when striving cease. Comforter, my all and all, here in the love of Christ I stand. In Christ alone, who took on flesh, fullness of God in helpless babe. This gift of love and righteousness, scorned by the ones He came to save, till on the cross. Christ Jesus died, the wrath of God was satisfied, for every sin on him was laid. Here in the death of Christ I live. Body lay, light of the world by darkness slain, then bursting forth in glorious day, up from the grave he rose again. And as he stands in victory, since Christ has lost its grip on me, for I am his and he mine, bought with the precious blood of Christ. No guilt in life, no fear in death, this is the power of Christ in me. From life's first cry to final rest, Jesus commands my destiny. And no power of hell, no scheme of man, can ever pluck me from his hand, till he returns or calls me home. Here in the power of Christ I'll stand. And no power of hell, no scheme of man, can ever pluck me from his hand, till he returns or calls me home. Here in the power of Christ I'll stand.